expiration 13, and she was awarded the joint emerging artist award at Flinders Lane Gallery, which she gave for a solo exhibition in 2014, which she did exceedingly well. And I think it was the same year that he won the
displayed the very graphic and
exact anatomical replicas of the human body in wax. That brings a very strange kind of energy to us. The materiality of wax really created this sense that they were real. And that kind of made me think about the concepts that I was kind of looking at in my work, but still bypassing, and thought, this is potentially a way to investigate and think in a sculptural sense how this can be incorporated. So, when I was there also, there were lots of squashed frogs on the road where I was actually staying. And they were very fleshy and raw and on the pavement, but it made me think back to this idea of the wax and the process of preserving birds as well that I'd already had in my practice. This sense of the fleshy, the delicate, the fragile, and presenting that. So that's how those works kind of came about. So the process and the fact that the death cast of preserving the trace of someone who's deceased was originally often done in wax. And all of these things kind of came together and had exact relevance in the processes that I've been working in. So it fit really well. So in doing that, the process, I use an alginate solution, which is, it's a very fussy, it's something that they use in dentistry, and I cast the bird in that, and it leaves the direct impression of it. Then I remove the bird, and then it's come out completely as it was. And then instead of preserving, this is the way that I've decided to preserve it, instead of taxidermically. So then I cast that in plaster and then create another mold of that in latex from the plaster trace. And then that's what is then cast in wax, which I layer up and tint in natural pigments to create this flesh illusion. And the transparency of the wax kind of creates these layers that really gives it that flesh quality. So then with the painted works, all the birds that are in the Found Fatalities series, they are actually the birds that are used in the wax. It's this double documentation of capturing the image of the bird as it was and then creating this like natural process of deterioration that naturally occurs. So it's preserved in a pictorial sense in the painting and then it is cast and creating the illusion that makes you think about the process that's yet to come, but in a not so literal way. And then that process then naturally occurs through it. And then with the other series, it is about thinking like paintings. It's about the history that the bird has and that sense of wanting to memorialise it and capture it in almost an imagined way to create like an imagined life that it kind of has after death and emphasising the texture of feathers, the weight and the stillness of the bodies and their physical appearance within the space that they're confronted by. It has a sense of their loss and to capture a past and a present of their own history. And with the horse painting now, that was one of the earliest works of the exhibition showcase that I did, which was during my time in New York. This did have the taxidermy process involved. involved with it in preserving now taxidermically, which she's in my studio actually. But this painting was an extension of that. It's a second rendition of capturing her presence, and it gives more of a life to it in a way that when I preserve it taxidermically, it's about creating this sense of a snapshot of death in a very reposed transition and a peaceful transition, because it's the death and the mortality of it is so intrinsically interwoven with the process of it. It's a strange thing to try and deny that, which you often see with all taxidermy works in museums. So the way that I approach it is in contrast to that. But the painting of it almost brings back a life to the work, which innately happens. It's through direct observation in my painting process, but yeah, it definitely creates this extra layer that creates this visual eulogy that never comes. And I think that's about it. But if any of you have any questions that you don't think I've covered, yeah?
The waxing process, the colours, how did you do that? What's the
colour mixing? So we've got base colours that are quite earthy that I choose. Well, then there's red, like your primary colours basically, but plus some earthy ochres and browns, and just colour mixing to get these fleshy colours which you tint the wax with. And then each layer I tint a different shade and a different tone, and then layer that through, which creates this very depth, muscular flesh kind of effect. Yeah.
And how long did it take to make one?
It's a very tedious process, because of the different steps that create. But in terms of once you get to the wax pouring stage, it's probably about an hour, because you've got to wait for it to melt and then pour and then tint the next lot and melt that. And so it takes about an hour for each individual one. And each individual one is unique, because it's all hand done. It's never going to be replicated, so even if you use the same mold. But yeah. Yes?
You were talking about,
yes,
how much did that change the direction of your work?
Very much so. This is something that I hadn't really considered before in my practice. It was something that I was aware that I probably should be maybe addressing it in a different way. But in terms of using wax and presenting it in such a way, I hadn't really considered before. And it wasn't until having that exposure to seeing things like that and the chance of being and interacting in the environment that I was in that made me question all these things, and then everything just kind of fell together, and I was like, this is something that really makes sense. It should fit in. And then it was just an experimental process in that way. So yeah.
Did you spend much time on your fitsie?
I did, yeah. It was wonderful. Yeah, amazing collection. So yeah, it was very beneficial in that way. Seeing everything, yeah. Yes?
Is there a reason why you have it framed? Like, you have a frame in another frame to put?
Yes, thank you. Sorry, I forgot to address that. So the idea of the framing particular shapes, it's a very classical style that, once again, is you often see in altarpieces in classical Renaissance type works, but it kind of made a resurgence back in the Victorian era and used in the aesthetic devices and display of post-mortem mementos, where they would have like death portraits and photographs, and it would then, it creates this level of remembrance and memorialization and notions of the afterlife. Because also the sense that often tombstones are often carved in that shape as well. So it's that layering of that undertone of after post-mortem representation. Yeah.
That's wonderful. Yeah, thank you, Michelle.
Thank you.